With the dawn of each new season comes another six-month journey, one that can begin with great uncertainty.
The Angels have tied their slowest start in franchise history.
6-14 record, we didn't keep our heads up.
Giant steps are required to complete this journey.
I'm not putting on a uniform just to put it on. I'm playing to win.
Other teams might grab your attention.
The Oakland A's have set a new record with their 20th consecutive win.
For some of the very best, the goal remains elusive.
17 years in the big leagues.
Will Barry Bonds be a part of the postseason series?
But above all, there is faith.
We're the only guys in the universe that thought we could beat them.
The Yankees are going home empty to New York.
And belief in a dream.
You start thinking we're going to the World Series.
The World Series will begin in Anaheim between the San Francisco Giants and the Anaheim Angels.
Baseball's first ever all wild card series.
It's a good day in baseball when the best player gets a chance to play in the World Series.
I don't care who pitches. When it comes there, I'm going to hit it out there.
Washburn says, let's go.
Barry Bonds in his first at bat.
What a great game. What a great series.
In a season of tremendous highlights, great moments, and fantastic wins, this one tops them all.
Think they got a rally monkey in the blimp?
Monkey, monkey, who's got the monkey?
Somebody with a chance to be a hero of this World Series.
We are mere moments away from the first pitch of Game 7.
Major League Baseball Productions presents the 2002 World Series, Heaven in 7. Sometimes, to reach baseball heaven, you have to go through hell.
And the Anaheim Angels now a disappointing 5-10 to start
the Angels season. Coming close, but not close enough. The Angels facing some pressure to turn it around here early in the season.
Anaheim began the season 6-14. And seemed destined once again to finish 41 games back in the ultra-competitive AL West.
We put so much into, let's get off to a good start right away and take care of the A's and take care of Seattle. And you know what? We played good baseball, we had good pitching, and we just lost. We lost close, good ball games.
The Angels already have their worst start in the history of the franchise.
After that 6-14, the team was up in Seattle, and Soch had a meeting before that game.
I really told the guys, hey, we believe in you. We know your championship caliber, and let's keep our heads up and keep going forward. And these guys did.
Swung on and missed strike three.
The Angels salvage the final game of this series.
It's a victory for the Angels.
I think what happened was as soon as we stopped playing our own division and kind of took that pressure off us to get off to that fast start, you know, we took off.
They began to win. Thanks in part to big surprises in small packages.
It is out of here! Grand Slam, David Eckstein! He's done it again! Unbelievable! Back-to-back ball games, walk-off Grand Slam!
When you got things like that happening, you tend to have an attitude of nothing can go wrong. And it doesn't matter what happens, somebody's gonna step up, even a little 4'2" guy like Eckstein can step up and hit the Grand Slam for you.
So the Angels are back up to the 500 mark.
14-14, back to square one. And nothing played a greater role in their resurgence than a dedication to their core values.
It's about being a team. I mean, every guy contributes, and there's a new hero every day in the lineup.
This year, we got on some stretches where early in May, when we won 20 out of 23, everybody was hitting line drives everywhere. And you can't defense line drives when everybody's doing it. So we're just putting pressure on teams by just hitting them to death.
The most runs scored by Anaheim since August 25th of 1979.
Throw the stats out the window. Throw the egos out the window. We got to play to win. And that means giving yourself up for the better of the team.
You don't know if it's going to be Garrett Anderson or Darren Erstedt or myself or Adam Kennedy or Jared Washburn or Donald. I mean, it's like we are made up of 25 guys. that are capable of winning the game for us. And that's just an unbelievable feeling to, you know, to be a part of.
Game-winning walk-off two-run homer.
Just another Halo victory.
This game is over. The Angels win.
The Angels grab first place.
They were now officially the Comeback Kids. Still, the eyes of the baseball world were focused on another divisional powerhouse on a record-breaking journey.
And it's 20 consecutive victories for the Oakland Athletics.
This is incredible. I mean, you tip your hat. I thought it was pretty cool that they were doing that. I mean, that's history. You just don't see stuff like that. But we don't worry about things we can't control.
We knew they were great, but we knew that if we win our games, it doesn't matter what they do.
With the pitching staff ranked third and the top batting average in the majors, the Angels finished with a franchise record 99 wins and did something they hadn't done in 16 years.
And the Angels have clinched a playoff spot.
Just up the state a bit, lived a giant. One fresh off a date with history.
He hammers it way back.
Number 60 out of here.
70.
He has tied McGuire. Number 70, the home run king. 72.
73.
Could his brilliance lead the Giants to the promised land?
See, that's the beauty of baseball. In spring training, the start of the season, you wish you had a crystal ball to sort of say, hey, man, you know, where are we going to be at the end?
When Bonds hit two home runs in each of his first two games, it looked like an encore was in the making.
Bonds hits one high and deep to left field. This one is out of here. On opening day, he's done it again. His second of the game. This one is out of here. Another one out of here.
You know, when you start a year off like that, picked up from last year.
He has done it.
And I thought that was like awesome. And we're like, okay, boys, here we go.
And so did Bonds, setting a record for sheer production by reaching base almost 60% of the time.
This year was probably the most productive year. For me, it was more remarkable than 73 home runs. The fact of almost 200 walks and how they pitched around him, how he stayed focused, and ended up winning batting title.
And this is it, number 600 for Barry Bonds.
Bonds' brilliance, along with a strong supporting cast, enabled the Giants to have the playoffs in their sight for the fourth time in the last 6 years. But a piece of the puzzle was still missing.
We knew that for us to get to the postseason, we'd have to have a bona fide leadoff man. You know, and Kenny Lofton was it. A guy that, you know, knew how to lead off, a guy that knew how to score runs, and a guy that had been in postseason in case we got there.
For Lofton, the move opened a door.
That's basically what I was trying to do over there in Chicago, was trying to get to the playoffs. And the opportunity came up for me to come over here, and I'll say, hey, these guys have a chance. And that's all I asked for, was just a chance to get to the playoffs and have a chance to get a ring.
You know, we got Kenny Lofton, we were behind. And he came in and made an impact right away at a home run, his first at bat.
Gone, a home run! Kenny Lofton in his Giants debut. Welcome, Kenny Lofton.
San Francisco finally had a bona fide leadoff hitter in place. Now they appeared built for a run deep into the postseason.
They are the wild card winners in the National League.
And the Giants are headed into October baseball.
October baseball had not been very kind to the Giants, especially in Atlanta. It had been even tougher on Bonds, who had one home run and six RBIs in 97 playoff at-bats, and had yet to win a playoff series in five heartbreaking attempts.
Back to the 2-0, now the 2-1. Line drive and a base hit! Justice has scored the tying run! Green to the plate! And he is safe! Safe at the plate! The Braves go to the World Series!
That was so far ago that he's gotten over that. So it was like it was perfect timing for him to put all this to rest and go out there and play the way he's been playing all year.
Finally, against his playoff nemesis Braves this year, he exorcised the demons in the deciding Game 5.
Oh! Goodbye, home run Bonds. Way out of here.
wasn't easy beating those Braves. Those Braves have been there many, many times. We knew that if we got by the Braves, we had a good chance of going to the World Series. Because the last 10 years, if you want to go to the World Series, you're going to have to go through Atlanta.
And the Giants are going to the NLCS.
Their next opponent was the sentimental favorite St. Louis Cardinals, who dealt with Barry by not pitching to him. But Barry's teammates would make the Cardinals pay.
Rich Aurelia, his second home run of the game. And the Giants have won the first two games.
Back in San Francisco, Bonds continued to go deep, even in defeat. The Cardinals had seen enough and pitched around him again in Game 4.
With two out and Santiago on deck, they will intentionally pass Bonds.
I got the chance to be the hero in the game, and I just try to put the ball on play and don't try the thing too much because, you know, it's not easy hit behind this guy. But on the other side, I love it because a lot of good things can happen.
Driven into left field. Two-run home run for Benito Santiago after the intentional walk to Barry Bonds.
The next night, more heroics, this time from Lofton.
Off and swings, line drive, base hit right field. Here comes Bell, rounding third, hitting home. Here comes the throw, and it's outside! And the Giants have won the pennant. The Giants are the champions of the National League. The Giants are going to the World Series.
17 years in the big leagues, and Barry Bonds is going to the World Series.
Back east, the Angels descended on hallowed and treacherous ground, the Cathedral of October baseball.
You get the feeling, though, this young, scrappy, aggressive bunch has a shot against New York.
You see no fear in their eyes.
It was definitely like the unexpected. You had no clue what was going to take place. And, you know, that first game was great. It was back and forth.
Yankees lead 1-0. Garrett Anderson, it's a tie game.
In the eighth inning, Bernie Williams hit the dramatic 3-run home run. But the funny thing about it, we all still felt confident.
Well, everybody didn't think we could beat them. I think we were the only guys in the universe that thought we could beat them. After the first game we lost in New York, I actually felt pretty good. I thought we played a great game. I thought we showed the Yankees and everybody else that we had a great team that was never going to give up. And we gained a lot of experience.
That experience proved crucial in Game 2. For though the Angels took an early lead, they also got a dose of New York's resilience.
And the Yankees take a 5-4 lead.
But could the comeback kids come back in Comeback City?
The Yankees are obviously a great team, and we had to play our best games to win. And in that situation, I mean, we were trying to do something to get on and start a rally, and Orlando Hernandez just left a couple pitches up to us.
The Angels have tied this game.
Fortunately, we didn't miss them.
With the series tied one game apiece, the teams moved west for the first playoff game in Anaheim since 1986. In the warm California sun, the Yankees' bats exploded, but the Angels never lost faith.
Honestly, I was sitting in the dugout going, yeah, 6-1, we're down, but I think we're going to win this game.
The Angels' bullpen stemmed the tide with 7 innings of shutout ball, led by 20-year-old newcomer Francisco Rodriguez, who was a revelation.
I saw him in AAA this year. You know, I was just like, oh my God, who is this guy? So I knew he was good.
Everything we heard about this guy was, you know, just wait till you see this, and you're like, okay, whatever. You know, I'm sure he's good, but let's see how good. He stepped on the hill that first time we saw him, and I was like, oh my goodness. I mean, you can just tell.
His poise just on the mound. I mean, he seems fearless, you know, for a 20-year-old kid to be able to step onto a stage like he's come onto and perform at the level that he's capable of doing, it's unbelievable.
He's been asked to do something that you just don't ask, quote, 20-year-old guys to do.
Strike three called, 6 in a row in the 7th and 8th innings. They put the rally monkey up on the scoreboard, and this place went berserk.
The Rally Monkey is the Angels' good luck charm that can't appear until late in the game. But when it does, the fans go bananas, and so do Anaheim's bats. Just ask the Yankees and their 6-1 lead.
That ball is gone! 9-6 Angels!
It was one of those few times where you're actually aware of everything that's going on as you're rounding the bases. I mean, it gave me goosebumps. I was running around going, is this like a something out of The Natural? I mean, it was just something out of a movie or something, you know? It was huge.
The following day, the Angels had a request for starter Jared Washburn.
Just do whatever I could to keep us in the ballgame, and then we exploded that fifth inning.
8 runs in the inning.
I remember I almost passed out a couple of times from jumping up and down and screaming that inning. It was a great feeling.
It was a great feeling to be able to come home and have the opportunity to beat them here without having to go back to New York.
The Anaheim Angels for the first time march on to the American League Championship Series.
These fans have given you that extra boost of adrenaline to get you over the top, and it was great to beat the Yankees at home in front of these fans.
Still, a dark Championship Series history hung over this franchise. In 1982, they blew a 2-0 lead.
Milwaukee, you have a World Series!
In 1986, they were 2 games up and 1 strike away.
And it's gone! Unbelievable!
And in 1995, a 13-game lead in August disappeared.
The Seattle Mariners are the champions of the American League West.
But in 2002, the Angels split their first 2 games in Minnesota. And when the series returned to Anaheim, Washburn once again came up huge. The Angels weren't about to let this bid for the pennant slip away, not with men that hit an incredible 320 in the postseason and a wonderkin who was masterful on the mound. You see, even 20-year-olds know that 42 years is a long, long time to wait.
Dives and he makes the catch! The ball game is over! The Angels have a 2-1 lead in this series.
And on clinching day, Adam Kennedy became just the 3rd player in LCS history to hit 3 home runs in 1 game.
I was shocked, and I saw him hit it, and I saw it look like it just floated. It just floated into the stands, and it disappeared in the sea of red, and I was like, whoa, he hit 3 homers.
He has homered 3 times. The Angels lead it 6-5.
I'm like, you got to be kidding me. This is ridiculous. We're having our cake and eating it, too.
He's our little sleeper, you know. I mean, people don't expect much, and boom, I mean, he socks it to you. How can you top that? That's just, it's unbelievable.
The jinx was over. These Angels had a date with a World Series.
They have the final ball come up.
And Prince hits a pop fly.
And it was hit to me. I was so excited. I couldn't wait for it to come down. And just the release of emotions.
And the Anaheim Angels are the 2002 American League champions.
Just to see that, when you're running up to the mound, you see your friends, you see your teammates hugging each other. Myself, I was going crazy. And we beat the Yankees, we beat Minnesota, we're going to a World Series where everybody never expect us to be.
You know, Fish, he's definitely one of the leaders on this team. You know, we got him and Erste and Percy, these guys that have been around so long. You know, myself, I'm a new guy coming in or whatever. So I just kind of sat back a little bit and watched these guys celebrate. It was the most amazing thing I'd ever seen.
It was the first World Series ever with 2 wild cards.
We're live at Edison Field in Anaheim. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Rory Marcus along with Terry Smith. It's game 1 of the World Series 2002, the Anaheim Angels and the San Francisco Giants.
The Angels had waited more than 4 decades for the chance to be on a World Series stage. Bonds, too, had endured a 17-year wait. And fresh off 2 of the greatest seasons ever, he was set to carry the team on his shoulders. Winners themselves, Giants manager Dusty Baker and Angels skipper Mike Socha, had shared World Series glory in 1981 as teammates on the Dodgers. Together, they learned their trade from one of the best.
Both of them played a long time for me. They played with a lot of desire, a lot of loyalty, and a lot of dedication. What I liked about Dusty was he always asked me why I would do certain things. He was a leader on the ball club, and he knew baseball. With Mike, the same thing. The way he handled the pitching staff, the way the other players looked up to him. Both of them had all the requirements that I saw to want to be a manager in a major league. I'm very, very proud of them, believe me.
The hands were dealt for the first All-California World Series in 13 years. It was time to play the wild card.
It's a sea of red out there in the seats. The fans are whipped almost into a frenzy. Terry, they've been waiting a long time for this.
The Angels take the field. Jared Washburn goes to the mound.
You dream about pitching big games when you're a kid, and pitching in the World Series is the biggest game you can get.
After putting down the first two batters, Washburn faced Jeff Kent with an eye on keeping the game's most feared hitter from reaching the plate.
Here comes the 2-2 pitch. Swung on and missed. Strike three. Washburn, as he's walking off the field, says, let's go.
You know, I'm always pretty intense, very competitive. I'm always screaming and pumping my fist, and some people probably don't like it, but I think it's upped a little bit when the games are this important.
A great beginning for Jared Washburn. The Giants go down in order. Barry Bonds left on deck.
Not to be outdone, Jason Schmidt needed just 9 pitches to get through his half of the first.
Here is Schmidt's 0-2 pitch. Swung on and missed. He blew that one right by him. So just like the Giants, the Angels go down 1-2-3 in the first.
Finally, the moment arrived. The game's best player stepped to the plate on the game's biggest stage. His world premiere at the World Series. It was a moment that truly called for something special.
Love him or not, it's a good day in baseball when Major League Baseball's best player gets a chance to play in the World Series.
But how do you face someone this locked in?
We're going to try to hedge it somewhat of, you know, pitching aggressively, but yet making sure he didn't hurt.
He's facing Jared Washburn, the left-hander right here. And a high fastball, Barry takes it.
All year long, Wash has been a guy that he's not intimidated or he won't back down from anybody. He'll go after him.
This situation dictates Washburn challenging Barry Bonds as much as he can. That just missed in the count, 2 balls, no strikes.
There was just something about him, his demeanor, like he was a man with a mission.
Swing, there's a shot deep into right field. That one is on its way and way back out of here. Home run. So Barry Bonds in his first World Series, in his first at bat in that World Series, launches a tape measure home run to the right of the 365 marker and way out of here. And the first blow of this World Series is struck by none other than Bonds himself, 1-0 San Francisco.
That's Barry. It's old Barry. I mean, you know, he has a flair for the dramatic. It didn't surprise us at all. I mean, we were quite happy to see it.
After 17 years, one swing.
Just one swing to seize the moment.
You get caught up in the game and the way it's going, and then you can feel the electricity in the dugout.
Oh, my God!
It's just spontaneous. I mean, it happens. It's nothing you sit back and think about when I'm going to scream or yell.
Way to go, B. So Bonds wins round one.
Barry Bonds, one of the best hitters ever, hit it out of the park.
Well, if Washburn was waiting all week to go after him, he doesn't like the result right now.
I kind of smiled. Wasn't surprised it happened because I made a mistake. So I thought, well, yeah, smile, shrug it off. Try to get the next guy.
Two batters later, Reggie Sanders, benched in game 5 of the LCS, had a shot at redemption.
You know, sometimes guys try and do too much and put a little too much pressure on themselves. We finally got him into a more relaxed feel.
There's a drive to deep right field. Tim Salmon back on that one at the wall, and that's 2 in the inning for the Giants.
As they had all year, the Giants played the long ball. For a 2-0 lead, the Angels seemed unfazed.
Hey, they're right there. Hey, solos don't beat us, remember? Solos are fine, let's go. Keep going, put some zeros up there, we're gonna get this guy. All right, let's go.
Never before had the first 3 hits of a World Series been home runs. But Troy Gloss now looked to change that.
I was just trying to get a gauge off Jason. You know, I'd never faced him before.
Here's the 0-1 pitch to Gloss. Swing and a miss. Oh, that's a good breaking ball by Schmidt.
I got two strikes on him. He fouled off some pretty good pitches that I threw him.
And the pitch is fouled away. Troy just got a piece of it.
I was just trying to get on base. You know, trying to get something started.
And I just kind of laid a slider in there.
Slider belted to left field. Barry Bonds will not catch that one. It's gone. Well, Bonds can do it. Sanders can do it. And Troy says, don't forget about me. His fifth home run of the playoffs.
He's proven it, you know. I mean, he's led the league in home runs, and that's no fluke. He's got some of the best raw power I've seen.
Troy Gloss has a pretty fluid, even swing for a right-handed batter, and that was crunched into left field.
Just as impressive was Washburn, whose fastball was sinking and rising. The Giants simply didn't know where to look.
The deal. You're changing their eye level.
It's the other way. Beautiful.
Yeah, that's right.
A lot of guys do it up here.
Yeah.
You like to do it down there.
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah, because I always throw up, so I want to make sure they see some down.
You see some down, and they got to follow the bounce. Beautiful.
Schmidt, meanwhile, was formulating a pitching plan of his own, and it was proving quite effective.
Yeah.
To be honest with you, I really hadn't heard a whole lot about the offense. I know different media and stuff writes a lot and see a lot of stuff on TV, but I want to make my own opinion of what I thought. What we did is we just kind of decided we were going to go after him.
Each time the Angels had their trademark rally in the works, Schmidt found a way to snuff it out.
The Angels are getting chances, there's no doubt about it. Now they need someone to come through with a clutch hit.
But that phase of the game was eluding them. No ifs, ands, or buts about it.
And it's popped up on the right side. Foul territory.
It went up, and I immediately called it so that Benito would know that I had it.
Foul territory, and Snow slips, recovers for the out.
I was lucky I fell on my backside because I never lost sight of the ball.
Flat on his back, the six-time Gold Glove Award winner. It's a big second out here in the fifth.
It was a big out because first and third with one out, there's so many ways you can score that guy from third. And now with two outs, it puts a lot of pressure on that guy behind him. He's got to get a base hit to score that run.
Swing and a miss. The Angels threaten but fail to score.
Who should know better than Snow that no two at-bats are ever alike? And with one on in the sixth, he began to figure Washburn out.
It's my third at-bat off Washburn, and I'd actually, my first two at-bats, seen a lot of pitches off him. My second at-bat, I had a real good at-bat and worked a walk, and I think I saw like 10 pitches off him and threw one right down the middle, got a good look at it, and I just tried to tell myself to drive the ball to left center.
Snow hits one into left center field, well hit, back at the track at the wall. To make it 4-1, Giants in the sixth.
For the second time in postseason play, Washburn had allowed three home runs in a game. But this was no solo shot, and Jared was gone. Still, this was a team with 43 comeback wins.
This team, we have no quit. We never think we're out of it. We get our nine at-bats. We think we have a good chance.
And this one is hit deep to left field. Bonds is back to the wall. It is another home run for Gloss. And it is 4-2, Giants. And this big crowd, 44,603, they're trying to get inside the head of Jason Schmidt right now.
Was another comeback in the works?
Hitting a home run gives team momentum. You know, just like the home run that Barry started off with gave us the momentum. When Gloss hit his home run, the team felt that they weren't out of it.
What a postseason Troy Gloss has had. Six home runs.
Next, LCS MVP Adam Kennedy brought the Angels even closer.
Into right field, that's going to get down for a hit. Homer scores, and it's a one-run game again.
The momentum was shifting the Angels' way, and the Anaheim fans were not surprised. Schmidt was gone, but he had done his job.
Their game plan is to get into the sixth or seventh inning with the lead, turn it over to the bullpen.
Felix Rodriguez stopped any further trouble.
They're in the World Series for a reason, and they have one of the best bullpens in the game.
And the leader of that bullpen was closer Rob Nen, one of few players in the ballpark with World Series experience.
Bottom of the ninth inning, and Rob Nen is in for the Giants.
Rob got his first two World Series saves with the wildcard Florida Marlins in 97, as the Angels soon discovered number three was inevitable.
Two out. Nasty pitch from the San Francisco right-hander.
There would be no monkeying around in this game, nor would there be a rally.
0-2. Then sets. The pitch on the way. Slider hit high in the air to right center. Over to his left, the center fielder Lofton. He's under it. Plenty of room. He's got it.
The Giants take game one from the Angels. 4-3 in front of a sold-out house at Edison Field.
We don't like comfortable leagues. Why change it? That's how we play. You know, that's what keeps this team up.
The Angels, as they have been in each of these postseason series, down one game to none. But unlike the previous two series, they lost game one here at home.
We needed a win. We needed to step up as an offense. We knew we had to put the pressure on them early, try to get to them and score a bunch of runs.
The Giants turned to right-hander Russ Ortiz. The Angels looked to the veteran Kevin Apier. Both had reputations for being effective but erratic.
Neither of these pitchers tonight stay ahead of the hitters. Does that translate to a long game? Probably.
Here are the Anaheim Angels on their home field, needing a win here tonight to avoid falling into a 2-0 hole.
And when the Angels need to fire up the engine, David Eckstein is quite often the spark. Eckstein led off with a single, and Darren Erstad brought him home.
Swing of a liner into right center field. That's a base hit. Eckstein digging to third, turns third, heads home. He's going to score all the way.
The Angels have Ortiz on the ropes early in the game.
Three consecutive hits by the Angels to get it started, and now they're thinking big inning.
Hit hard and into right field. Here comes Erstad to score. Four consecutive hits.
Talk about hits and runs coming in bunches.
Our team's been in this situation so many times this year. We just kind of feed off a couple hits, and you get a few runs, and it's built up to some big innings for us.
The Giants are certainly capable of scoring runs in bunches themselves. So the Angels, while they're hot, want to get as many as they can.
Good idea. For when Apier walked Bonds in the second, it spelled trouble.
People think that Barry's only going to beat you at a home run. But if you keep walking them and getting them on base, I mean, that's more chances for us to score.
A one-out single put runners on the corners for the resurgent Sanders.
Now Sanders suddenly could put the Giants right back in this game with one swing at his bat.
Sanders gets into one to deep left field, a three-run home run for San Francisco.
He gave us a huge lift, you know, down 5-0, hits a three-run homer. Hey, we're back in the ballgame.
They'd get even closer.
Dave, make it happen. Come on.
I've faced Apier quite a bit in the past, but it's always different in the playoffs.
Come on. Get out of here. Get out of here. Yeah. Come on, David.
You know, he had the lead there, and he was just coming after us, and we were able to get the ball up in the air, and the ball was carrying pretty well down.
What Apier's done here is not be able to retire the Giants and have let the Giants back in the game. It would be demoralizing to another team. But the Angels will just keep fighting and doing the things they do best.
The Angels did precisely that in their half of the second. And once again, Eckstein's bunt single spawned the rally.
Jim Salmon, big, strong, right-handed hitter. Really gets down into a deep crouch. Here's the pitch. Fastball, there's a drive deep down the left field line. Heading into the corner. Bonds onto the warning track to the wall. It is gone!
So the Giants are going to make a change, and Russ Ortiz has a terrible outing in game two of the World Series.
Ortiz left in the second, Apier in the third. The shortest series outing by two starters in 45 years.
So Apier does not last much longer than did Ortiz.
and the starter for game four for Mike Socia, John Lackey, is coming in.
Socia is managing this game as though he has to have it.
At that point when I came into the game, I was really just kind of taking it as a start. I didn't know how long I was going to go. I was just going to go, you know, as hard as I could for as long as they left me out there.
So Lackey quiets down the Giants in a hurry.
Needing somebody to come in and kind of shut down their offense, let our guys get back to swinging the bats.
The Giants countered with Chad Zerbe, a 10-year minor league veteran, embarking on four gutsy innings. An epic relief appearance by World Series standards.
On to first for the double play.
The performance Chad gave was huge. A lot of people don't realize that guy hasn't pitched in a game in about 3 weeks. And to come in last night and throw about 60 pitches a night, it was a huge lift for us.
Down by two in the fifth, San Francisco struck again.
The Giants with the bases loaded with one out. And JT Snow, the former Angel who put the big hurt to his former team last night, not trying to do it again. A base hit to the outfield could tie this game. Ground ball into right field, a base hit. Aurelius scores. Here comes Bonds. He will score the tying run. And JT Snow does it again. The Giants, who were down 5-0 after one inning, have now tied the game.
They didn't stop there, scoring two more for the lead. But this game was far from over.
Well, the one thing I do know about the Angels is they will keep coming at you.
Trailing by one in the sixth, Anaheim called on Francisco Rodriguez to add still another chapter to his amazing story.
He's 4-0 in the postseason, and they are his first four major league victories. He's been a big leaguer for about a full month.
Francisco Rodriguez gave us a big lift, keeping us at that 9-7, then we got 9-8, just giving us a chance to come back and make a little rally.
Got him on a slider, struck him out.
For a young kid like that to come into this type of postseason situation and perform the way he has, it's kind of special. I don't know if we'll see it again for a long time.
He has thrown six pitches and has struck out a couple of National League All-Stars in succession. And now here's the matchup that a lot of people are interested in. The young Rodriguez and the great slugger Barry Bonds.
Straight up. Go right after him, trying to make the right pitches, you know, trying to keep the ball down in the zone.
There's a hard hit ground ball right at Spezio. He'll solo to the bag, and it's a 1-2-3 inning for young Frankie.
In the bottom of the sixth, the Rally Monkey made his first Fall Classic appearance, with Erstad on second for Anderson.
Garrett, the Angels' top RBI man this season. And boy, could the Angels use a hit from him here.
Base hit. Here comes Erstad. Here's the throw by Sanders. Cut off. Tie game.
The Angels had evened the score. And the amazing K-Rod kept it that way.
He went through a very, very tough lineup in fewer than 30 pitches in three innings, which is incredible.
Here comes 0-2. He got him.
Not only did he retire the entire Giants lineup consecutively, nine in a row, he did it throwing 25 pitches, 22 of which were strikes. Now that is dominance.
The Giants came out swinging the bats, and they really kept the pressure on us. And when he came in, it really shut the door. Those were huge innings for us. Give us a chance to get back into it.
At the end of the eighth, K-Rod left the World Series stage. The Angels' shortest tenured player turned the spotlight over to the man who'd been with them the longest.
Two out in the eighth for Tim Salmon.
You know, in that situation, I wasn't trying to do too much, just trying to keep the inning going. And when you're facing guys we haven't faced before, and I didn't really know what to expect, so I just went up there being ready to hit.
The Angels' 10-year veteran and their all-time leader in home runs and RBIs had played almost 1,400 games before reaching the postseason, the longest such stretch of any active player. He wasn't about to let the moment slip away.
He's been in this organization his whole career. He's dedicated his life to the Angels, and to have him come up so big in such a big-time game, I was just so happy for him.
We saw him last year struggle through a year and came out this year and started slowly, so to watch him battle out of it and then come in the postseason and have a night like that, just to see him enjoy that kind of success on this stage is great. soon as I hit it and I knew it was a home run, I knew the significance of it and what it would mean, you know, with Percy coming in the next inning.
Percival was prepared for one thing, but this was so much better.
I thought I was coming into a tie ball game and told myself, hey, you get the first two guys out and then be real cautious with what I do. Once we scored the two runs, I said, okay, now the focus has changed. You go attack the first two guys, and if you get them out, great.
Troy did, in fact, get those first two outs, which made it that much easier to face Bonds.
Two-run lead right there with nobody on. You really don't have to have much approach other than don't walk him. I'm going to throw a strike. If he's taking a strike, great, I get a free one. If he's not, you got a chance of getting him out. You got a chance of him hitting a home run. You take what you get.
I became a fan. I wanted to see Percy challenge him and see what, you know, that's a great matchup right there.
You can see Salmon saying in the dugout, that's the furthest ball I've ever seen hit.
Percy challenged him and Barry, you know, I mean, he rose to the occasion. I mean, what can you say? I mean, he hit a ball that I've never seen a ball hit that far.
That's why you make sure when Barry comes up, no one's on base.
It's special anytime he steps to the plate because you kind of halfway expect something like that to happen.
But for all the majesty of Barry's blast, Percival persevered.
The Angels win the ballgame, 11-10. The crowd rejoices. What a show put on by these two clubs. The Angels' first ever World Series win. Just another Halo victory.
Game 3 was a poignant reminder of the past.
The last time a World Series took place in San Francisco back in 1989, just before the start of game number 3.
As word began to filter in just how bad the damage was, Major League Baseball postponed Game 3 until the Bay Area could cope and recover.
6.9, that's the major Bay Bridge collapse.
It took 12 days before Game 3 was played. It took more than 12 years for the next Game 3 to return to San Francisco.
1989 was the last World Series game played here, so it's been a bit of a wait. It'll be the Giants and the Angels in Game 3 of this 2002 World Series.
Got some players over here, boy. Yeah,
that's why you're in the World Series.
It's fun.
Catalyst Kenny Lofton was hoping the home field would wake up his bat.
Stay back. God dang it.
And Bonds was so focused, it really didn't matter who was pitching for the Angels.
Have you hit out this guy before?
I don't care who pitches. When it comes there, I'm going to hit it out to him.
The reigning Giants home run king, Willie Mays, threw out the first pitch to Bonds, his godson. Mays probably would have enjoyed facing Anaheim starter Ramon Ortiz, who in 2002 gave up 40 home runs, the most in the majors. But in the bottom of the first, it was a walk to Lofton that gave Ortiz trouble, especially when Kenny made him pay with his speed.
Lofton goes to pitch to Aurelia, swing and a miss, throw down to second. Is high the tag, not in time. Lofton stole it.
After Jeff Kent reached base on an infield hit, the Angels chose to intentionally walk Bonds to load the bases with one out. Having grown accustomed to the strategy, Benito Santiago looked to make the Angels regret it.
The Giants with a hit could be off to a great start. Ortiz sets the pitch to Benito. Breaking ball is tapped towards second. Kennedy will only be able to get one, and the run scores. Lofton comes in. It's 1-0 Giants.
San Francisco had to be confident with LeVon Hernandez on the mound. LeVon was the MVP of the 1997 World Series and had an unblemished record in the playoffs.
LeVon had never lost in postseason, and he had been throwing the ball very well. This guy will throw any pitch at any count, and he's very, very tough.
But the Angels gave him trouble by playing hit and run in the third.
Here's a spot on 3-1. Eckstein takes off. Erstad rips it fair down into the corner. Eckstein will dig for third and hold. It's a double for Erstad. And it's second and third with nobody out for the Angels here in the third.
The Angels now are set up nicely. Nobody out of their big hitters coming up. So here now is Tim Salmon.
Here's the 2-2 pitch. Ground ball to third. Off the glove of Bell. He throws to first base low, and it's too late. The run is in. The Angels tie the ball game up at 1-1. And Salmon beats the throw to first base.
Moving to his right. Ball took a tricky hop, hitting the heel of the glove. Then he hurriedly throws low, but can't get Salmon.
After Garrett Anderson flew out, Troy Gloss set his sights on breaking the 1-1 tie.
The runners go. The pitch is whacked into left field. Erstad around third. He will score. The Angels get their first lead of the game, 2-1.
I think our club does a great job at making adjustments in which we see what the pitcher's doing. Once we get in that situation and once the inning starts going, no one wants to make that final out. We want to keep pushing and keep pushing.
Troy Gloss gets a bullet into left field to drive in the go-ahead run here in the third inning.
This was the Angels' attack that had rattled pitchers throughout the playoffs. But the Giants had to be surprised they were getting to their veteran playoff pitcher and sought a strategy for Scott Spezio.
All right, just make sure he stops over here. Don't let him get any running jumps on you. You're fine. Get that double play right here. Back up home plate now.
2-1 to Spezio. There goes Gloss. The pitch is lined into right center field. That's in there for a hit, and it's going to roll all the way to the 421 side. Salmon scores. Gloss scores. It's a triple for Spezio. The Angels lead it 4-1.
His strength is unpredictability, throwing a pitch at any time and getting the ball down and trying to get some ground balls. When you see a lot of line drives, you know they're centering the baseball.
That the Angels batted around in the third was amazing for a World Series game. That they would do so again in the fourth was unprecedented.
Two men on with one man out. Here is Garrett Anderson, and Hernandez right back into some serious trouble.
There go the runners. It's a strike, and there'll be no throw. They got a great jump. It's a double steal.
I was looking at Erstad, and I couldn't get anybody's attention to do a spin move or do something to keep him close because they were timing him the whole time.
Erstad saw an opening to try to steal third base, and the key there was Tim Salmon being able to recognize that Erstad was going to be aggressive to follow him to second and give us a huge opportunity of putting runners on second and third.
And now the Angels have runners on second and third, and there goes the ground ball double play possibility.
Anderson's RBI ground out finished Hernandez for the night. But reliever Jay Witasek wouldn't fare much better. The Angels were doing this without the benefit of a home run, and Spezio had become an RBI machine.
Here's Spezio, ground ball toward Kent. A dive cannot come up with the ball. It's into right field for a base hit. But Salmon is coming to score. It's another RBI for Spezio, and it is a 6-1 Angels lead.
A very difficult lineup fielded by the Angels. Contact, 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 often hard contact.
Now the 0-1 delivery. There's a shot off of Witasek, and the ball caroms into left field for a base hit. Closer on third being waved in. And the ball hit off the pitcher Witasek. It drives in a run. It is 7-1 Anaheim. My goodness.
Witasek stayed in the game. But Anaheim would add insult to injury.
A 1-1. Molina dumps one into right field. That gets down for a hit. It's 8-1 Angels.
They get that merry-go-round going. There's no stopping them.
The serenity outside Pac Bell Park belied the tremors inside as the Giants looked ready to explode.
Well, these Giant fans who have not had much to cheer about tonight, trying their best to get their home club going.
One down, and here is Aurelia, the right-handed hitting shortstop.
Aurelia, deep to left, looking up, is Anderson out of here? And
and it's 8-2.
Kent followed with a single. And with a 6-run lead, the Matador chose to face the Raging Bull.
Bonds could make it a 4-run game. One on, one out. Bonds in the center field. Back at the wall. It's a 4-run game. Another blast from Barry Bonds.
We're just trying to go low and away, try to get that corner outside. I think the pitch he hit was like right middle, waist height for Barry, the big guy. He hit it out.
That was phenomenal how far that ball traveled to dead center field. With this, he becomes the first player to hit home runs each of his first 3 World Series games.
In the hardest part to hit home runs in all of the major leagues, Bonds continued to shed the burden of the ghost of playoffs past. Still, there wasn't much else the Giants could do in their World Series home debut. From the very start, this one belonged to the team in red.
Sean Weiss delivers, and the pitch is swung on and missed. Strike 3. The Angels pound the Giants in Game 3. 10-4 the final score, and just another Halo victory. They've done it again. The Angels lead the World Series 2-1. At Pac Bell Park in San Francisco.
Welcome to Game 4 of the World Series. As the series shifted north, everyone expected the Angels' bats, like the weather, to go into the deep freeze, but it has been business as usual for this Anaheim club.
The Anaheim Angels have been rampaging around the bases almost at will over the last 2 games, but Dusty Baker and the Giants feel as though they have a pitcher that can stop that tonight.
Dusty Baker is very pleased that this game is falling in the hands of Kirk Reeder.
What's Reeder got? How far has he got to go for you? 6, 7?
I hope so.
Yeah.
That's what I said. If he goes up to 7, boy, I'm in the White House.
On the other side, John Lackey, he's already made an appearance in this World Series in Game 2. Giants say, well, let's see how he comes back after that a few days later and pitches in this Game 4.
But before the pitching fireworks got underway, Major League Baseball unveiled its greatest moments as voted by the fans.
Every fan is connected to the game by a chain of remarkable events. Here are the 10 most memorable moments in Major League Baseball history.
I was so proud to be out there in Game 4, to be in Pac Bell, and to see how the nice presentation, and to realize that I was living during some of those greatest moments. Not only that, but I had a chance to be a part of that.
Hey!
I was looking at him, and he knows all the players, he knows their numbers, he knows their batting stances. Just thinking about what a wonderful year it's been, and you know, how fortunate we felt, I felt, for us to be there.
Kirk Gibson, number 8, Cal Ripken Jr., Pete Rose.
I told Pete I played the game hard because of him, and he just looked at me and smiled and said, thank you. And since you touched the hit king, I said, well, we're going to get a lot of hits tonight.
But before the Giants' bats could get booming, Reeder would have to silence the Angels. And keeping Eckstein off the base paths was a good start.
Swinging a bouncing ball to Aurelia. Big hop at the knees. The snow, one out.
Early on, you're looking for good breaks. There's one right there.
You know, I just tried to go into it with the same attitude that I have, you know, all the regular season and my other postseason starts. And, you know, just try and keep the ball down, let my defense work, and give the guys a chance to win and keep it close.
Lackey's strategy was a bit more basic. Simply, keep the ball away from Barry Bonds.
Every time he came up, it was a situation where you don't want to let him hurt you. So we intentionally walked him, put him on, and took our chances with the next guy.
Well, they're going to walk Bonds again, just as they did last night, with runners at first and third, and one out.
It's like playing with fire, but this time, Benito Santiago got burned.
Swinging a bouncing ball near the bag in second. Eckstein steps on second, throws the first, double play, and Lackey gets out of it.
The Giants miss a golden opportunity in the first inning.
The Angels scored a run in the second to take a 1-0 lead. In the third, they threatened once again.
This is a matchup that Kirk Reeder wants to stay away from, facing Blas with men on base.
He's already hit 6 postseason home runs. And he gets into one to center field here. Back at the track, at the wall. It is gone. A home run, number 7. A 2-0 pitch. 3-0 Anaheim.
In that situation, off a guy like Kirk Reeder, you know, he wants you to get you out in front, wants you to try to pull. So I was trying to make sure I stayed, you know, up the middle, right center. And he left the ball up a little bit.
And unless these Giants pitchers figure out a way to slow down this Anaheim offense, Giants are going to have to figure out a way to outslug this Anaheim team.
So in an effort to keep the game from spinning out of control, the Giants turn to their secret weapon, the second best hitting pitching staff in the game.
1-2 pitch, Reeder. Slow hopper, Molina out, a wicked bounce, the throw to first, not in time.
The ball hit off the front of the plate and just it took a funny spin when it hit the grass, and it was just perfect placement. It was in between Benji and I, and neither one of us had a play.
You couldn't place a ball much better for an infield hit. Or could you?
Reeder at first with nobody out. Lofton bunts it, third base side, and this one is going to roll and roll and roll and roll, and it's a fair ball.
Bloss picked it up, thinking it was foul, and it was called fair by the home plate umpire, Mike Winters.
I think Troy saw it go foul and right away went to grab it, and as he was picking it up, it trickled back onto the line somehow. The advantage of playing at home, you might know how the line is sloped and things like that, but I think that could have happened anywhere.
Two infield hits here have really saved the Giants and put them in a situation where they may be able to do something.
Preferably something that would travel more than 20 feet.
2 balls and 2 strikes to Aurelia. Here's the pitch. Swing and a drive in a right center field. That's a base hit. Here comes Reeder. He's chugging home. Lost it to third. Scoring is Reeder. It's 3-1. Here's the next pitch to get. Swing and a high pop up into right field. Lofton may challenge Salmon. Salmon's underneath it. He makes the catch. Here comes Lofton. Here's the throw. Not in time. Lofton scores. The ball shoots by the catcher, and Aurelia slides into second. It's a 3-2 game.
Which Aurelia took second. It does open up first base, and it gives the Angels the easy option of walking Bonds to put runners at first and second with one out for Santiago.
Barry, he's a threat, you know, especially with guys on base. With a right-handed hitter on deck, I think Mike just felt more comfortable loading the bases again, going after Santiago.
Who had already hit into 2 double plays after walks to Bonds, but the LCS MVP wasn't about to make it 3.
Swing a line drive, base in center field. Here comes Aurelia. Hurstead's throw is online. Aurelia slides. He's in there. This game is tied. Santiago has come through.
Benito's been doing the job for us all postseason, hitting behind Barry. We were just glad he was 1-for-3 in that situation because the one was a big one to tie it off.
With the score 3-3, Reeder bore down. He had already started a rally with a hit. Now he sought to stop one with his hustle.
The Reeder, who ended the 5th inning with a 6-4-3 double play, looking for that again.
Richie came in and said, hey, you know, he might try and go the other way, and if he hits a ground ball there, make sure you cover first, because we can turn a double play.
The 1-0 to Molina, swinging a bouncy ball, Snow's got it to his left. He goes to Aurelia for one. Reeder covering first, double play! And Reeder, with all kinds of emotion.
In those situations, and you know, with your home crowd into it, like they were, when I got that double play, the emotions just came out.
It was time for the bullpens. Felix Rodriguez pitched a scoreless inning for the Giants, and Francisco Rodriguez continued to baffle everyone he faced.
Francisco Rodriguez has not yet allowed a Giant to reach base in this World Series.
But that streak would come to a halt in the 8th.
One into right, the leadoff man is on.
The Giants finally with a hit off Francisco Rodriguez. Dusty Baker has the option of pinch running for Snow, a slow runner.
I thought about pinch running for him, but the thing about it is, you know, we're playing at home. And since we had the last at bat, decided to not only leave JT out there, but also if the game remained tied, to have my defense out there.
Sanders hadn't laid down a sacrifice bunt all year. As it turned out, he wouldn't have to.
Sanders is, now he shows one, lets it go by, and it gets by Molina, and Snow goes to second. A gift for the Giants.
Sanders popped out, and up came Bell. K-Rod had been a Goliath, so who better to slay him than David?
Swing and a drive up the middle of base hit. Here comes Snow rounding third. Hurstad's throw is a good one. Snow's line. He's in there. And the Giants take the lead.
It helps to be fast, but JT can score on second on a base hit. I mean, he gets good lead. He gets good jumps. You know, that's what it takes to be able to score. And I knew if I could put the ball in play hard and hopefully get a hit that he'd be able to score.
4-3 in the eighth on a hit by David Bell.
San Francisco couldn't have scripted a better ninth inning scenario.
The Giants have exactly what they want, then in the game with a one-run lead.
Just watch those guys over the last few games. They're definitely an aggressive team. I wanted to go out there and make sure I got ahead of them, make sure that you know, they were hitting my pitches and not the other way around.
And set. Here's the pitch. Swing and a check, swing, ground ball to short. It could be up here. A real step on second. Throw to first. This one is over. Game four goes to the Giants, and this baby is all tied up at two.
The Giants had used small ball to beat the Angels at their own game.
Everything was falling for them. It usually falls for us. We're playing against the Giants. I mean, they're the best team in the National League. We're the best team in the American League, and anything can happen at any time, and we know that.
People don't expect the Giants to play little baseball. Get to the National League Championship Series and the World Series, you do things to get one run. That could mean the difference in a game. We're going to do whatever we can to get one run.
The Giants and Angels will go into Game 5 tomorrow, with each team having won two games in this series. Coming to you from Pacific Bell Park here in San Francisco, this is Game 5 of the 2002 World Series. And another sellout crowd here at Pacific Bell Park, a very live crowd last night, and we're expecting the same type of atmosphere here tonight. And tonight, it'll be Jared Washburn taking on Jason Schmidt.
When you look at the whole season, these two teams have played 175 games. The one who wins the next two of three is going to be the world champion.
All right. Have you heard enough stats? Let's go. Let's play ball. It will be Jason Schmidt right in the heart of it all, ready to take on this Anaheim Angels lineup.
And he quickly found himself in a jam with two on and two out in the first, and the Angels' hottest hitter at the plate.
Two balls and two strikes to Troy Gloss. Here comes the 2-2 pitch. Swung on and missed, strike three.
And they blew it by him, and Gloss looking very disgusted as he tosses the bat away.
He has his blazing fastball working extremely well. He bared down at times when he needed to.
Into the bottom of the first inning we go.
An 18-game winner during the regular season was Jared Washburn.
Jared was looking to rebound from his rough start in Game 1. But he'd first have to temper the suddenly red-hot Kenny Lofton. Lofton had more postseason appearances than any player on either team, more than 50 games worth. And he hoped his experience was rubbing off.
When you get a guy who feels comfortable being in that situation, it's just guys understand that, and I've been there before, and I know what it's like. So just having me here is just, you know, letting guys know how simple it is.
Swinging a line drive to the left field, a base hit. And Lofton continues to stay hot.
Lofton's leadoff single wouldn't have been much of a problem for Washburn were it not for his one-out walk of Kent. But that then forced a decision on bombs.
And here you go again. First and second, one out, Barry Bonds at the plate. The Angels walked him in this situation yesterday. It appears that they are going to pitch to Bonds.
Here's the pitch.
Bonds lines one down the right field line, a base hit. Lofton scores easily, and it's 1-0 Giants.
It's important to get your feet on the ground and make pitches, but the Giants didn't give him a chance. Jared never really got his feet on the ground. And, you know, at times you got to tip your hat to the other club.
Washburn laboring through this first inning. Two runs to the board. Three men on.
Here's the 3-1 to David Bell. High, he walked him. A run comes in for the Giants. It's 3-0.
The Giants batted around, and Jarred tied a series record with 4 walks in the inning. Meanwhile, Jason Schmidt had the Angels flailing.
Swing and a miss, and Molina strikes out to end the inning.
The Angels go down in order in the second. We'll see if Jared Washburn can have a better inning here. The Giants sent 9 men to the plate in the first. Lofton started things with a single, and here he is again.
Swinging a liner back through the middle, base hit into center field. In these last 2 nights now, 5 for 6, and it seems like he's been starting rallies with all of his hits.
Lofton would, in fact, do just that once again, though Aurelia had his role in the rally snatched away.
Hurst on the move, he dives, and he makes the catch!
Timing the dive, fully extended to his left, and grabbing that one.
But Erstad's gem was merely a bump in the road for the Giants. For following a double and a walk, they had the bases loaded for the second straight inning.
So Santiago steps in there with the bases full of Giants.
And the first pitch to Santiago.
Swing and a base hit! Lofton scores! Here comes Kent! Here's the throw! He slides! He's in there! It's 5-0 Giants!
You have to keep adding on, because at some point in this game, the Angels are going to make a run at you.
But a comeback seemed unlikely, for the Angels were having little success making contact with Schmidt. He struck out 8 Angels, the most by any starter they had faced in a postseason game. But as Schmidt's strikeout total grew, so did his pitch count, and by the 5th inning, Anaheim started to chip away.
I went out there and I tried to exert a little bit more when I had already been probably at my peak level.
The big right-hander throws. And a changeup in the dirt, swung on and missed. The ball gets away from Santiago. Breaking for the plate is Eckstein, and he scores. And the second run of the inning scores. It is 6-2 Giants.
We felt like we were still in the game. We felt like we had the opportunity to come back. We knew if we just kept chipping away, that we would have an opportunity to tie it up and take the lead.
Drilled into left field, down the line, and off the wall. Coming in to score is Salmon. It's now a 6-3 ball game.
The Angels made it 6-4, and in the bottom of the 6th, sent Ben Weber to the mound to hold the fort. Weber retired the first 2 Giants he faced, but Aurelia singled, and Jeff Kent came up, looking to break out of a slump.
No balls and a strike to Kent. Here's the pitch.
Oh, my!
Hits it deep. Anderson back at the wall. Out of here! Jeff Kent has done it. A 2-run home run. It is 8-4 San Francisco.
Those runs were huge. And it seemed to, take some air out of them when they were thinking they were coming back.
That's a backbreaker right there.
The night got worse for Anaheim in the 7th. Lofton's triple scored 2 runs, although there were 3 Giants at the plate.
It is really incredible how aware JT Snell was to recognize that Darren Baker, who's only 3 years old, was standing almost in the direct line between David Bell and home plate.
I was on 3rd, and when Kenny hit that ball, I think everybody thought it was a home run. So I went back to 3rd to tag up, and when I hit the wall, I just kind of was running home, and David Bell was behind me. I got right before the plate, and I noticed a kid or something jetting in behind me. I was pretty sure it was Darren, because he's our bat boy, and he's so eager to go out there and grab the bats.
Kenny Lofton was his favorite player. He wanted to get his bat because everybody else went to go get his bat. So he just ran out there and got it.
3.5, he can fly. He was close to the plate already, and I didn't know if he was going to slide. I didn't know what the heck was going to go on. I was like, oh, no, it was too late.
I kind of reached behind me and grabbed him by the front of the jacket.
He actually started reaching for Darren Baker before he touched home plate.
Yes, he did.
Kind of drug him a little bit and lifted him up and just held him for a minute and made sure he was okay. And I don't know if he was quite sure what had happened. His eyes were big, and he was speechless looking around, and luckily he didn't get hurt.
That could have been a very damaging thing that happened around home plate.
Thank God JT was there. And JT got the best hands on the team, so it was just appropriate that JT would catch him.
He says, thank you, JT.
Just had to happen in front of the whole world in the World Series. And I just knew I was going to hear from my mom, from my wife, because they had been telling me already. As soon as the game was over, the first
ring, I picked it up with my mom. I told you so, one of those I told you so calls.
Save that videotape for Darren Baker. That's a memory.
The final game of the season at Pac Bell Park had turned into a blowout. And the Giants' Superman this night was, quite appropriately, a man named Kent.
Can he do it again? Yes, he did! Jeff Kent with his second two-run homer of this game.
With their 12 home runs in five games, the Giants had tied the record for the most ever hit in a World Series. And 16 runs was the second highest total in a World Series game.
And the San Francisco Giants emphatically win game five, 16-4.
It was one of those days where we couldn't get them out. You tipped your hat to them, but guess what? There's going to be a game six.
They have a 3-2 lead going back to Anaheim. One win away from winning their first World Series as the San Francisco Giants.
And the San Francisco Giants are here in Anaheim as we prepare for game number six of this 2002 World Series.
Let's go, Pop. One more time. You hear me?
Well, here are the Giants, one win away from their first World Championship since 1954, since before the move out west.
Think they got a rally monkey in the blimp? What's up, Robin?
How are you? What's going on? Congratulations on saving that kid.
You're trying to be in disguise tonight?
Yeah, I'm going back over here.
You got your fatigues on?
Yeah, it's like working slow. Good game, boss.
Thanks. Game. How's it going?
Good. I'm happy to be here.
Are you?
Yeah. The rescue was the best.
All right.
Child savior.
Take it easy.
Bad boys are always safe. Thanks for joining.
It's a do-or-die game for the Angels. They have to win it to force a game seven.
Kevin Apier had struggled mightily in Game 2 and now found himself in a first-inning jam in Game 6. A two-out intentional walk to Bonds put Jeff Kent in scoring position for Benito Santiago.
Popped up. He's going to get out of it. So they walk Bonds intentionally, and it pays off in the first inning.
Russ Ortiz also lived a nightmare in Game 2 and was anxious for redemption.
I knew I had to execute and able to help this team win. And so I said in my mind, you know, hey, I need to execute this time.
For Russ Ortiz has been terrific.
And Apier matched him pitch for pitch.
When their guy was throwing zeros up, Ape was right there with him. Ape went out there, threw up four zeros. He got us into the fifth inning. It was a great effort.
In the fifth, Apier and Sean Dunstan waged a classic battle. In 26 postseason games, Dunstan had never hit a home run, but he could never say never again.
Said, I'm up there hacking. He threw a fastball middle end.
Driven deep into left field, back is Anderson at the wall. 2-0 Giants, home run Sean Dunstan.
But then I see my son at home plate, and he had a big smile on his face, and I was like, wow. I really hit a home run in the World Series in front of my son. That's a beautiful moment.
Biggest swing of the bat in his long big league career. And Sean Jr. was right there watching.
When Kenny Lofton followed with a double, it marked the end of the night for Apier.
Apier battled. He did a good job, but might have been running out of some gas.
Gas is what Rodriguez had thrown the entire postseason. But when he took the mound in Game 6, he had trouble putting his power over the plate. After Lofton stole third, K-Rod missed the target once again.
In the dirt, here comes Lofton, 3-0 San Francisco.
The wild pitch gets the Giants a valuable third run.
In the sixth inning, with the score still 3-0, K-Rod and his nasty reputation were still in the game.
He's nasty. He's a nasty young man, and you know, you just like to see somebody get to somebody that nasty.
And who better than the nastiest hitter on the planet?
And here is the great home run slugger, Barry Bonds, against the great phenom, Rodriguez, the pitch. That is crushed deep into the night, and it's 4-0, San Francisco.
Bonds' fourth home run of the series was his record 8th of the postseason.
I saw later in the replay that I mean, that ball disappeared down that tunnel down there. Because I saw the people looking in the tunnel. I said, what are they looking at down there? That was Barry's ball. Must have been rolling out on the freeway somewhere.
And not only did he clobber it, it was Ruthian, epic in proportion.
And when Barry hit that bomb, I said, oh, boy, look at Barry.
A perfect year, a perfect series. Now the title was tantalizingly close. But what about these Angels?
They've had so many rallies this year, so many late-inning heroics. Do they have another one left in them?
4-0 Giants, trying to wrap up the World Series tonight.
Ortiz carried a one-hit shutout into the sixth. The Angels' outlook was bleak. But then Adam Kennedy singled, and a two-out walk to Erstad gave Anaheim a ray of hope. Was Ortiz starting to swim upstream with Salmon at the plate?
Now he throws. Fastball. Strike three call. And so we head to the late innings. And the Angels are still four runs down.
You know what? I was frustrated. And I walked out there thinking, you know what? We might have, you know, that might have been our opportunity to get back in the game. And I think we gave up a run the next inning.
A two-out RBI hit by Kent. Who pumps his fist as he looks into the dugout on his way to first. It's 5-0 San Francisco.
Personally, like I said, I was frustrated and a little down, and I kind of thought that maybe that was the end of it. But when I came in the dugout, I saw that the rest of the guys weren't thinking that. So I was happy.
But these Angels didn't know the meaning of the word quit.
We were down 5-0, but we knew if we had any outs left, we're going to keep fighting.
And in the seventh, they'd turn to their good luck charm.
They put the rally monkey up on the scoreboard, and this place went berserk.
The fans just go crazy seeing that thing, and it gives us a nice boost of adrenaline to go up there and try to kick butt.
The rally monkey has made several appearances, urging everybody to crank it up.
And once again, facing Ortiz, that's precisely what they did.
And then that inning, there were two balls that were smoked pretty good. We would say, man, you know, they're on Russ. It's 5-0. We were hoping we'd get him through that seventh. We know Felix was running on empty. Everybody's running on empty. The dangerous Spezio coming up there was probably their hottest hitter and decided to make the move.
Here comes Dusty Baker. Dusty's had such great production from his late-inning relievers, especially Felix Rodriguez.
And they said we were going to go with Felix, and so I was like, all right, you know, I did everything I could for as long as I could. Everybody in our bullpen does such a tremendous job that it's like, how could you not feel good about bringing in one of the best, you know, right-handed relievers in the game? You know, we had to feel pretty good with the 5-0 lead.
Dusty Baker said, you deserve the game ball tonight. Russ Ortiz took the souvenir with him.
I gave him the ball because I was rewarded for what he did. Some of the Angels I heard took exception that I was showing them up, but they weren't even in the equation. It was about showing Russ appreciation.
It wasn't anything besides a souvenir, something, a keepsake, because who knows, this could be my only World Series that I ever participate in.
Ortiz had his memento. And in the Giants' clubhouse, preparations were underway. After all, they had a 5-run lead with just 8 outs to go. Felix Rodriguez was on to pitch with 2 men on base.
Gloss at second, Fulmer at first, 1 out in the 7th inning. This is a big at-bat for Scott Spezio.
I know it was a huge at-bat when I was coming up there. I was preparing myself to drive in a run any way possible. I knew we needed a spark, and I knew we needed a run on the board. It was a tough at bat. He's been tough on me the whole series.
Rodriguez delivers, and it's a fastball outside.
I think I took 2 pitches that were real close, and then I fouled off 4 of them that were outside. He just would not come in.
You can see Santiago wanted that fastball in. That's a dangerous area right now. If you make a mistake away, it's a single. If you make a mistake inside, it's 5-3.
The 3-2 pitch is belted to right field.
I knew it would have a chance, but it felt like a half hour going down to first base, and I was praying, go out, please, God, let it go out somehow.
Going back, Sanders, the warning track.
You know, I was standing on first base. I don't think I've done that in my whole career where I'm actually standing on first base waiting for the ball to go out.
Back to the wall, it's gone!
Are
breathing and right back into it.
We knew that was the one thing we needed to get us back on track. And, you know, Spies came up big for us all year long, and right there was the biggest moment.
You know, when Spies hit that home run, it was like you kind of get that sensation like, oh, man, maybe this is the start of it.
And I was like, man, that was huge. I mean, to me, that might have turned the whole series around, because anything other than that three-run homer, even a single or whatever, they're still not within prime striking distance.
I'll tell you, if somehow, some way they did come back and win this game, what kind of momentum would they have going into tomorrow?
But tomorrow wouldn't matter if the Giants weren't held at bay. In the eighth, Brendan Donnelly was once again masterful. He struck out Sanders. Then with Bell, it remained a two-run game. Now, it was the Angels' turn. Tim Worrell would face the meat of the order.
The big bats coming up for Anaheim in the bottom of the eighth.
Ortiz had held the first four batters hitless, but that trend would quickly come to an end with one swing of the bat by Erstad.
There's a swing, a long drive deep to right, has a chance, it is gone! Darren Erstad with a home run! It is a one-run game!
There is nothing you can say, you just have to admire the tenacity of these Anaheim Angels.
Now down by one, the rally was kept alive by Sammy.
A drive into center field, Lofton can't get it, base hit, and the tying run is on base. Here comes Sean Biggins to run for Salmon.
Two straight hits, why not three? And Anderson would deliver.
Pop down the left field line, a long run for Bonds, he won't get to it. Biggins to third base, Bonds stumbles and falls. Biggins stays at third, Anderson to second.
The mistake by Bonds was costly, and Worrell was done for the night. It all came down to Troy Gloss against Rob Manny. An historic comeback on the line.
I mean, I don't have a whole lot of experience facing Rob Manny. I mean, we all know what he throws, but seeing it from the perspective of being in the box compared to the camera in center field is a whole different story.
Giants are hoping that Nen could work some of that magic again right here.
I was trying to get a pitch I could basically just hit on the ground, get something to score one run, tie the ball game up, and then go on from there.
The never say die Angels giving their fans a thrill down the stretch. Claus trying to get the hit that could possibly send us back here tomorrow. And it's belted left field in the gap. It's in there for a double. Here comes Biggins. Here comes Anderson. The Angels take the lead. 6-5.
This is hard to stop these guys once they get on a roll.
Plus, another key hit.
T-Roy has a knack of coming through in game-winning situations. He's done it all year long. And for him to come up there and drive that pitch out to the wall, we were all just thrilled because we knew we had Percy coming in for the ninth.
And Percy showed no mercy.
Troy Percival comes on to try and nail this one down. 2-2 pitch. Swing and a miss. He struck him out. Playable. Loss. 2-1.
The Angels are one out away from sending it to a game 7 tomorrow when they looked like they were dead and buried tonight.
And the Giants, faced with a very real prospect that their best chance to win this World Series has come and gone.
The 2-2 pitch.
Swung on it! We're seeing it tomorrow night. And the Anaheim Angels are still breathing. We are going to game 7 incredibly. 6-5, the Angels have defeated the Giants with an incredible comeback in the late innings.
Well, what was on the line with us as far as facing elimination in that series? I don't think I've ever been involved in a more exciting ballgame.
On the day of Game 7, Game 6 hero Scott Spezio made the year's last trip to Edison Field.
What do you say? We were dead going into those last innings, but the crowd gave us some added adrenaline that boosted us and got us through it.
Great hit last night.
Way to
go, buddy.
Good job, baby. Hey. How are you? I'm a player.
You're a player?
Yeah. All right, go ahead. One more. Let's do it.
Let's do it.
All right.
Let's go, Angels! Let's go, Angels! Angels!
Easy money, what's up, Wade? Hey, this is our guy right here. Let's do it. We're gonna do it today?
All
right, baby.
Angels! Game 7!
It's fun to think about everything's riding on this one game.
It's do or die tonight. The Angels and the Giants. Game 7, they'll decide it tonight. The crowd standing and cheering, the thunder sticks banging together. The sea of red is ready to go tonight.
And here's the rookie, John Lackey.
It was a huge game, big game, but I knew what I had to do was not different than any other game.
Glad you're with us. Away we go.
Lackey was looking to become the first rookie in 93 years to win a deciding Game 7 in the World Series.
Kennedy.
I was trying my best to look at it as another start.
Here's the 1-2 to Aurelius, swung on and missed. Molina has to throw it down to first base, and there are two outs.
I was on short rest, so I was just going to go as hard as I could for as long as I could.
John Lackey winds, and here he comes, 3-2. It's hit in the air to right field. Salmon giving ground. On the warning track, he makes the catch, and Lackey has a 1-2-3 first inning.
Giants starter LeVon Hernandez was hoping to regain his playoff prowess after getting bombed in Game 3.
There will be a short leash for LeVon Hernandez if he struggles here early. He's walked two in the first inning here and deals with Garrett Anderson, two on, one out. A 1-1 pitch to Garrett Anderson. Into center field, Lofton coming on. Makes the catch, Eckstein doubled off to end the inning.
A rare Angels mistake gave the Giants a boost.
Here's Benito Santiago. It was only 4 out of 23 against the Angels. Here's a 1-2 pitch. Santiago up the middle, under the glove of Eckstein, and a one-out hit. First base runner of the night for the Giants.
One out in the second inning, no score.
Snow now sought to become the first player in 15 years to get a hit in all 7 games.
Goes 3-2 pitch and a shot into right center field. That ball will be cut off by Erstad. Santiago will hold at third, and it's first and third, one out as the Giants threaten here in the second.
After a gut-wrenching loss in Game 6, the Giants look to gain an early Game 7 lead.
The stretch, the 3-2 pitch. Swing, and there's a high fly ball into deep left. Going back to the warning track, Anderson, he's under it, he's waiting, he makes the catch, tagging up at third, Santiago, and he comes in to score the first run of the 7th game. It is 1-0 Giants.
But LeVon asked for trouble in the bottom of the second when he surrendered a 2-out walk to Spezio.
That'll bring in Benji Molina.
Here's the 2-1, a line drive into left center field. Lofton and Bonds won't get it, it splits the outfielders. It comes off to Lofton. Here comes Spezio to the plate. He scores, and the game is tied.
Hernandez continued to have problems in the third.
The 1-1 pitch to David Eckstein is lined into left field. Bonds toward the line, plays it on a hop. Base hit for Eckstein.
Here's Erstad. He had a sacrifice bunt his first time. A 1-1 pitch. Into left field, another hit.
A pitch to Salmon. Hit him. An opportunity was knocking Lanaheim.
Angels have the bases loaded and nobody out.
They could really cash in right here.
Anderson, he was the big RBI man for the Angels. This is the spot where he was at his very best.
Having the bases loaded there with nobody out and Garrett up to bat, you were very confident that he's going to come through.
The pitch to him. A line drive down the right field line. Lead
Garrett had led the majors in doubles with 56. Yet this was his first extra base hit in the World Series.
The fact that it was Garrett, I think, put us in the best of all positions to have our biggest RBI guy up in a situation like that. And he came through as he has all year.
Once he hit that ball and gave me a little bit of a cushion, I knew, you know, I had to step up and I had to make that stand up.
Right-hander against right-hander, 0-2 pitch. He got him, struck him out. He took that pitch right down the heart of the plate.
Lackey sure didn't look like a rookie. And in the fifth, he got support from his defense while facing David Bell.
Here's the 3-2 delivery. And that one is lined into left center field. Erstedt coming in hard, dives and catches it. You can put stars around that one.
Lackey did precisely what the Angels asked of him.
In my mind, we just want John to give us five innings because ultimately what we want to do is get in our bullpen.
Brendan Donnelly followed with two scoreless innings, escaping a jam in the sixth.
Looks like we're going to have a pinch hitter for Sanders, Tom Goodwin.
There are a couple situations that we had gotten one hit or pinch hit. We'd have been back in a game or had a chance.
Asking for a big pinch hit, Tom Goodwin. Second and third, two out, 4-1 in the sixth. Getting over.
The Giants had been so close to a championship, but now it was slipping away. Rodriguez came on in the eighth, anxious to put an exclamation point on an exceptional postseason performance. The Edison Field crowd was on fire.
Rodriguez winds and comes back 0-2, and it swung on and missed. A wicked slider gets Aurelia. Three-pitch strikeout. Frankie winds, here's the 1-2 offering. Swing and a miss! Strike three! He strikes out Kent. Rodriguez delivers, and he struck him out! Santiago goes down swinging, and Frankie Rodriguez strikes out the side in the eighth inning.
Here was a situation, Game 7 of the World Series, where three rookie pitchers came in and pitched eight innings of one-run ball, and obviously turned it over to our closer, who's one of the best in the game.
We move into the ninth inning. Game number 7, and Troy Percival, 6-for-6, and save chances in the postseason.
JT Snow leads off the ninth inning. Two balls, two strikes. Percival delivers to Snow, and it's whacked into right field. And the Giants will not go easily.
A walk brought the tying run to the plate. It was mano a mano for the title.
So Yoshi Shinchō will be the pinch hitter for Pedro Feliz.
Troy Percival, the Angels' closer all year. He sets his 1-2 pitch. Is swung on and missed. Two outs. The Angels are one out away.
Kenny Lofton with two on, two out.
Troy Percival trying to send the Anaheim Angels to the promised land. Here's the pitch to Lofton. Fly ball center field. Erstedt says he's got it. Erstedt makes it. As the Anaheim Angels win it all.
They begin every season with the hope the journey will end just like this. But the dream of just one team really does come true.
Last year, the Angels finished 41 games out all the way to the wild card this year, and now a world championship.
Unbelievable. I can't even imagine. I just can't believe this is really happening.
World champion.
World champion. Is that amazing? Yes, that's unbelievable.
Gene Autry, I know you're up there. Your beloved Angels have done it. The Big A is finally the home of a champion.
Like it was Dreamville, where I was born. Like light years from here, and the air smelled good in Dreamville.
Woo! God,
I don't even know how to act.
I don't either.
It was true.